there are no shortage of questions we'd like answers to in this life, right? Will the Mets ever win another World Series, right? Will the Knicks a championship? They came close around the year I was born, but didn't make it. Why do subway fares continuously rise and yet service remain the same, sometimes worsen? How does cocaine find itself in the White House? That's a thing, by the way, if you didn't know. So there are those, right? But then there are perhaps even more crucial questions, right, that we've all asked ourselves. What kind of man or woman should I marry, right? How should I raise my children? What kind of career should I pursue? And arguably the single most posited question of all men, whether verbalized or not, what is the meaning or purpose of my life? Right, and no doubt there are many other questions that remain unanswered, sometimes to our frustration, but which of these is the most important question? Right, what ought we to consider most? Right, what really matters, or have we missed it altogether? Because the reality is, we can learn endless facts, right, about this subject or that subject, and yet remain unchanged, right? Theoretically speaking, I suppose we can possess omniscience, right, so as to uncover what truly happened to that submersible, right, or to discover potentially habitable planets in our galaxy, or even to get to the bottom of every age-old mystery and conspiracy since the dawn of time, right? And yet, still, knowing all that stuff failed to resolve our greatest dilemma, namely, our separation from God on account of sin, right? You see, certain questions, irrespective of the intensity of our curiosity, are best left unanswered, right? And not necessarily because of any immorality or confidentiality, though sometimes so, but rather because of their triviality, right, and their irrelevance. It's possible to know many things which ultimately have no bearing on how we live our day-to-day lives, right? And more importantly, where we shall go once this life is up. King Solomon, in the opening chapter of Ecclesiastes, had much to say about this. Ecclesiastes 1, 16 through 18, I said in my heart, I have acquired great wisdom, surpassing all who were over Jerusalem before me. And my heart has had great experience of wisdom and knowledge, and I applied my heart to know wisdom and to know madness and folly. I perceive that this also is but a striving after wind. For in much wisdom is much vexation, and he who increases knowledge increases sorrow. However, in the pursuit of true wisdom, which even King Solomon understood to be of tremendous value, Scripture paints for us a much clearer and more critical picture of the type of questions we ought to be asking in this life, right? And I believe chief most on this list of questions is, who is God and how has he revealed himself to us? Of course, this assumes that there is a God, right, and one who must be taken at his word. And yes, that is entirely reasonable because it is rooted in a very reasonable truth, right? The Bible opens in Genesis 1:1, as we know, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. In the beginning, God. And contrary to the opinion of many skeptics, to believe and promote this truth is not circular reasoning. In fact, it's no less circular reasoning than an infant who automatically assumes that in order to keep on living, he or she must continually breathe. And you'll notice that they do this well before they can even or fully or partially understand the mechanics behind what it is they're doing, right? It's just taken for granted, right? We don't first examine our nostrils, even as adults, and arbitrarily determine whether or not they're fit for the intake of air. We just do it, right? We take it for granted because it is very real, based upon a very real principle, as is God, right? But even more real than breathing is the reality of God, who so graces us with every breath we have, right? After all, the very first of us, as you might recall, Adam, was animated via God's very breath, right? Nevertheless, while there either may come a day where we breathe our last or our breathing is changed entirely, right? When Christ comes back, we don't know what we'll be. God and his word will never change. That will always remain the same. He will always endure forever. And it is by this word that he's revealed himself to us. And one passage in the Gospel of John presents us with this question, and not only the question, but the answer as well. Please turn with me there now in your copy of the scripture to John chapter 10. John chapter 10, this is the Gospel of John chapter 10. We'll be looking at verses 22 to 30. We Please follow along with me as we read. Again, that's John chapter 10, verses 22 to 30. And there we read, At that time, the Feast of Dedication took place at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the colonnade of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." Jesus answered them, "I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name bear witness about me, but you do not believe because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one." And the title of this sermon is Question of Questions, or The Question of Questions. And so that we might better understand and examine this question and explore its answer, I've divided the text into three simple points. Point number one, the questionable sleuth in verses 22 to 24. Point number two, the undeniable proof, verses 25 to 29. And lastly, point number three, the incontrovertible truth, verse 30. But where are we contextually, right? Where do we find ourselves in John's account? And set in the context of this passage, we find ourselves with the Lord and his disciples in the city of Jerusalem. Looking back from chapter 7, we find that Jesus, by this point, had likely been in or around the city for about the past 2.5 months, having discreetly come up from Galilee for the Feast of Booths. During that time, he both preached and taught often in the temple concerning himself. He spoke about the authority from which both his teachings and Advent, right, and his coming were based, as well as the end to which his earthly ministry was destined. Right, with an open and inviting heart, he specified the fruits of salvation for all who come unto him empty, right, to the spiritually parched, rivers of living water, right, which itself would flow abundantly from the hearts of all who drank, John 7:38. To those blind and dwelling in darkness, true sight and true light, even the light of life, right, itself emanating from him who is the light of the world, right? John 8:12, 9:5, and 9:39. To the slave of sin, freedom by the Son in the knowledge of the truth, John 8:31 to 36. With Jesus later in John's gospel, right, revealing himself to be the very embodiment of truth, right? The way, the truth, and the light is who he is. And of course, for those who keep his word, an unfamiliarity with even the taste of death, right? In other words, eternal life is their consolation, John 8:51 to 52. Now, at the same time, alongside these invitations, right, and self-declaration, his I am statements, were sober judgments sharply aimed at all those unwilling to accept the same, right, all those unwilling to come to him empty. To the world, though, especially the Jewish religious elite, comprised largely of scribes, Pharisees, and those under their influence, we read from Jesus' own lips things like, "Its works are evil," John 7:7. This is why he was initially reluctant to go up to Jerusalem to begin with, right? When his brothers who had not yet believed in him urged him to go up to reveal himself at the feast. He knew that he was hated on account of the testimony that he brought against them, right? Declaring that their works were evil, the testimony of the unbelieving Jews. And he knew that that posed an issue. But lest we wrongly conclude that he was fearful of worldly disdain, and we know he wasn't, we would do well to remember that everything Jesus did was according to a set plan, right, in a divinely fixed schedule, right? And thus, as he was keenly aware, his time, right, that is the time to suffer and die, had not yet come. And therefore, he had to tread quite carefully. And there's many instances in the gospel where there were near-death instances for Jesus, but his time had not yet come, therefore he didn't die. But among some of the other ways in which he testified against the world and the Jews included the exposing of their hypocrisy and unsound judgment, right? Thinking themselves lawkeepers in their own estimation, but being lawbreakers in actuality, John 7:19 to 24. He then points out their complete ignorance of the very God they presume to worship and adore and obey, right? John 7:28 and 8:19 and 8:55, right? He says, "You don't even know God. You don't know the Father. If you knew the Father, X, you know." He even pronounces their prohibition from entering that place to which he was going upon his departure from this earth, right? Namely glory, the glory of heaven, right? This is, of course, the place to which he would soon ascend and remains to this day, right? But as he made it clear, it would not be a destination for those who die hardened in their sinful unbelief. He then denounces them as self-deceived sons of the devil that live to do his will, the devil's will, right? Lying, murdering, persecuting those who walk in and proclaim truth. Furthermore, he reveals that another reason he came in the world was to actually further blind, right? Or rather leave in blindness all those who profess to see, that think that they see, but actually don't see a thing at all, right? The healing of the man born blind, which I preached on about a month back from John chapter 9, as well as the ensuing response by the Pharisees and then Jesus himself was recorded for us, right, to underscore that distinction, right, and a divine one at that, between people, right? A distinction made not on the basis of any irrelevant categories, right, such as ethnicity, class, ability, things that we kind of separate ourselves from other people today, right? But grace. This is a distinction of grace, God's unmerited favor, unearned favor, right? Was it anything other than grace which compelled Christ both to encounter and heal that blind man? Of course not. You know, surely there had to be other blind beggars in the city of Jerusalem, even then, right? But none, at least not that day, were present who experienced the unmerited and unsolicited kindness of God, right? At least certainly none who arrogantly claimed that they could actually see, if indeed they couldn't. This man couldn't. And this is a distinction that carries forth into our chapter 10, right, where Jesus begins by making two more of his I am statements. Firstly, that he is the door of the sheep, right, by whom only the shepherd may enter, but also that he is the good shepherd of the sheep himself. Right, a shepherd who has a particular selection of sheep. And what this distinction began to create amongst the people was this ever-growing division, culminating in what I believe may very well be the question of questions, right? And that question is he, Jesus, the Christ? This is a question I pray each of us here will deeply and honestly consider, right? Whether we've come to the correct conclusion about it or not, right? Because bottom line is, how you answer this question, seriously, and I don't mean just verbally, how you respond or how you check off a box, how you answer this question, right, even from the deepest recesses of your heart, right, a conviction you know to be true or not, will determine where you spend the rest of eternity, point blank. And it also determines who you are. But coming now to our passage, we look at point number one, the questionable sleuth in verses 22 to 24. And I'll read that again. Follow with me. John 10, 22 to 24. At that time, the feast of dedication took place in Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the colony of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." So we see Jesus in Jerusalem, right? In the temple, a place that he'd frequented since childhood. Right, and one which he'd commonly go to teach and preach, especially. After all, the temple was the seat of virtually all worship, right, religious and ceremonial worship in Israel, in Judea, and for a time had been the physical representation of God's house on earth, right, a place in which he caused his name to dwell. And speaking of God's house, on at least two occasions, separate occasions, the Lord, Jesus, consumed by zeal for what he acknowledged to be, one, his Father's house, but two, also his house, violently drove out money changers who'd irreverently used sacred courts for a place of commerce and trade, and irreverently so, right? In fact, on one such occasion, he does so while quoting portions of both Isaiah 56:7 and Jeremiah 7:11, wherein we read from Luke 19:47, it is written, "My house shall be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers." Notice he says, "my house," right? Already a clear hint of his true nature peeking through there. But why was he there in the first place? Verse 22 tells us, right, that the feast of dedication was at hand, and that was the reason he was in the city. But what was the feast of dedication? Exactly. Right, the feast of dedication, as it was so called at that time, was an 8-day winter festival beginning on the 25th day of the Jewish month of Kislev, right, which typically falls somewhere around November or December on our calendar. And it was not one of the feasts that was instituted by Moses back in the Old Testament, right, as a statute, but rather an extra-biblical feast, right, a feast that has its roots outside of the scriptures, commemorating the dedication, or rather rededication, of the Jewish temple. Now that raises the question, why, you might be wondering, was the temple being rededicated to begin with? Well, roughly 330 years before Jesus, that is before his incarnation, Judah, along with Syria, Egypt, and much of the known world at that point, to be frank, fell under the control of this guy by the name of Alexander. They say he was great, but anyhow, when Alexander unexpectedly departed this life at the ripe old age of 32, he left an enormous leadership vacuum, and without a legitimate heir, the entirety of his conquests were now instantly divided between his four most prominent generals overnight. Now, Judah, being situated where it is, found itself on the border of the kingdoms belonging to two of those four generals, that of Ptolemy to the south, based out of Alexandria in Egypt, and Seleucus to the north, out of Damascus, which would have been the Syrian-Persian region. And both, while mostly resolved to peacefully coexist, those two kingdoms, right, nevertheless remained at odds over the issue of the Jewish borderland, right? Each vying for control of the Jewish people, one through cultural assimilation and economics and other things, and the other through brute force and military conquest. And for the next 125 years after the death of Alexander, Jews would be engrossed, right, in this delicate balancing act, albeit one of relative peace while they were under predominantly Ptolemaic rule. However, in the end, it would be the conquering Seleucid dynasty that prevailed, and for a period of about 35 years after that, though primarily the latter 10, the Jewish people would suffer greatly under the iron thumb of tyranny and sacrilege. In 174 BC, Antiochus IV Epiphanes, a title Epiphanes, which means the illustrious one, or get this, God manifest, ascended to power and began placing intolerable restrictions on the people. Right, during his reign, he made decrees prohibiting Sabbath observance, outlawing certain rites of Jewish worship, even ordering the Jews to worship Zeus rather than Yahweh. Right, in an act of brazen disrespect, Antiochus raided the temple in Jerusalem, stealing its treasures, and set up an altar to Zeus. And on this altar, which itself would have been an abomination, right, a foreign altar, he ordered the sacrifice of swine, right, which would have been unthinkable in their eyes, swine, pigs, you know, unclean animals to the Lord's people. And when the Jews expressed their outrage over the profaning of their temple, reasonably so, Antiochus responded by slaughtering a great number of them, selling the rest, the survivors, into slavery. And he issued even more draconian decrees, right? At one point, performing the rite of circumcision, right, which was a requirement on the eighth day of any Jewish male born, was punishable by death, right? And Jews everywhere were ordered to sacrifice the pagan gods and eat pig flesh. So as you can imagine, the camel's back was completely obliterated by the mountain of straw, right? Leaving the Jews with no other alternative than to revolt, right? To take up arms and fight. In fight they did. In 176 through 166 BC, Judas Maccabeus led the Jews in a series of guerrilla-style assaults against the forces of Syrian Greeks, right? And after vanquishing successfully the Antiochus and the Seleucids, the Jews cleaned up shop and restored the temple in or around 164 BC. And rabbinic tradition has it that when it came time to relight the menorah, right, the lampstand, which would have been a sacred instrument of their worship, they searched the entire temple, but only one jar of small oil bearing the pure seal of the high priest could be found. And miraculously, this small jar of oil burned for 8 days until a new supply of oil could be brought. And from then on, Jews everywhere to this day have observed this holiday for 8 days in honor of the historic victory of the miracle of the oil. And today it's known more commonly as Hanukkah, or the Festival of Lights. So by the time of our Lord's arrival, this had already been a thing for well over a century, right? Nonetheless, while the Jews were commemorating a glimmer of light following a period of, to be honest, great spiritual darkness, the light of the world and the one who would preserve them from throughout the entirety of their existence was beaming in their very midst, ready to deliver them from the darkness, not of the Seleucids or any other military force, but of their own sin. But as a whole, they did not receive him. You know, we just read in John 1, he came to his people did not receive him, they did not believe him, right? And in reality, he would later go on to lament, Matthew 23, 37 to 38, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the city that kills the prophets and stones those that are sent to it. How often I would have gathered your children together as a hen gathers her brood under her wings, and you were not willing. See, your house is left to you desolate." But here, in our passage, we see Jesus in the temple, walking in the colonnade of Solomon, also known as Solomon's portico in some of your translations, or also Solomon's porch. And what this was it was a roofed archway, right, walkway, flanked on the outside by great walls and the inside by these tall marble pillars. And it ran along the entire eastern wall of the temple complex, opposite the temple entrance, right? And it just so happened to also be adjoined to the eastern wall of the city of Jerusalem itself. And though technically not Solomon's temple anymore, right, as the one he'd constructed had been destroyed and rebuilt over 500 years prior when the Jews were exiled to Babylon, there was nonetheless a portion later dedicated to him in his honor bearing his name. And if you know anything about King Solomon's reign, then you'll recall that it was marked by a period of great glory and unprecedented prosperity, economically, militaristically, spiritually as well. But as Jesus elsewhere remarked concerning the judgment that was to come upon that generation of Jews that he was speaking to and dealing with, something far greater than Solomon was here, right? And he just so happened to be gracing those walls with his presence, right? And this particular part of the temple was known even then as a place of congregation. It was a meeting place. For there weren't any restrictions to who can be in there, unlike some of the other courts. You know, there were courts of the women, courts of the Gentiles. There were distinctions there, but in this place, anyone can come. In Acts 3, chapter 3, Peter, accompanied by John, following the miraculous healing of a lame beggar, preached a short sermon about Jesus from the portico. And scripture tells us that it was from this place that they taught, proclaiming the gospel of the resurrection and calling listeners to faith and repentance, right? So there's certainly a history surrounding this place. Two chapters later, even in Acts 5:12, we see Solomon's portico once again featured, this time as an early gathering place for the apostles. It became a base of operations, if you will, and from which much healing and, of course, teaching and preaching was done. And given that Jesus and the disciples were at the onset of winter now, right? They were there at the onset of winter, the fact that at least it was partially insulated from the wind, the rain, the snow, and what have you, made it more than ideal for gathering. And if the goal of our Lord was to preach and teach to as many people as he possibly could who were in the temple, that would have certainly been the right place for it at that time of year, certainly, which reveals his wisdom, right, and his readiness both in season and out. But as we'll soon see, not all who gathered around him did so with good intentions, right? In verse 24, if you look, we see a gathering of Jews. And it should be noted that not all the Jews, right, when we use this term Jews, were the same, right? Jesus was a Jew, according to the flesh, right? And so were his disciples. On top of that, many of the forgiven faithful were Jews. But fairly often in John's gospel especially, when we see the term Jews being used, it's usually in reference to those individuals that oppose him, those Jewish individuals that oppose him, the scribes, the Pharisees, and again, those influenced by them. They were, after all, Judea's religious elite, Jerusalem being their headquarters, right? And so it was only logical that the temple would be the epicenter of all their gatekeeping activities, right? At the beginning of John's gospel, he records that a delegation came out to them from Jerusalem to Bethany across the Jordan, right? They had come to demand his testimony, as many were coming out to John, right, from all over the surrounding region to be baptized. And as you might imagine, this raised certain red flags, as they were supposed to be the spiritual leaders of Judea, not some, you know, at least in their eyes, John was supposed to be this great man, but they saw him as a Nazirite prophet dressed in camel's hair, living off of nothing but locusts and honey, right? Thus, this began their investigation, right, as sleuths, investigators, into the messianic activities. We can read this in John 1:19-28, and I'll read it and this is the testimony of John. When the Jews sent priests and the Levites from Jerusalem to ask him, "Who are you?" he confessed and did not deny, but confessed, "I am not the Christ." And they asked him, "What then? Are you Elijah?" He said, "I am not. Are you the prophet?" And he answered, "No." So they said to him, "Who are you? We need to give an answer to those who sent us. What do you say about yourself?" He said, "I am the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Make straight the way of the Lord,' as the prophet Isaiah said." Verse 24, now they had been sent from the Pharisees. They asked him, "Then why are you baptizing if you are neither the Christ nor Elijah nor the prophet?" John answered them, "I baptize with water, but among you stands one you do not know, even he who comes after me, the strap of whose sandal I am not worthy to untie." These things took place in Bethany across the Jordan where John was baptizing. And so in keeping with their ongoing investigation, upon gathering around Jesus in the temple, right, we see that their first utterance is a question, followed by a demand. Verse 24, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. Right? What they're saying is essentially, stop playing games. If you're the Christ, you know, say so. And taking that face value, the words themselves, there's not much wrong with it. However, one thing to keep in mind is that behind every question or demand, or particularly question, is a questioner, right? A fact Jesus understood quite well as he knew the hearts and minds of all men. And concerning these questioners, there were preconceived notions about who the Christ was and who they expected him to be. Furthermore, by this point, and for some time now, they had been committed to Jesus' demise, right? Talking about those preconceived notions, right? Recall the healing of the invalid by the pool of Bethesda from John chapter 5. Brother Benito just preached on this a few weeks ago. Though he had performed an extraordinary and benevolent work, having just healed a man who was disabled for nearly four decades, their grievances remained. Why? Why were the Pharisees upset about this? Because he did this work, as well as many others, on the Sabbath. Thus, in their minds, violating the law they appeared committed to uphold. And these grievances only deepened when he began to speak about himself and God on equal terms. John 5, 15 to 18, the man went on his way, and this is the man that was healed, the invalid. The man went on his way and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had healed him. And this is why the Jews were persecuting Jesus, because he was doing these things on the Sabbath. But Jesus answered them, my Father is working until now, and I am working. This is why the Jews were seeking all the more to kill him, because not only was he breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. But you see, even before that, Jesus had not met their expectations of who they thought the Christ would be. All right? But who was the Christ to be? In their minds, at least. Moreover, what is the significance of that name? Well, firstly, it's not so much a name as it is a title. The word we understand as Christ, or Christos in the Greek, is itself a translation of a Hebrew word, Messiah, which means anointed one. The Christ or the Messiah was supposed to be the anointed redeemer and restorer of Israel. Remember, Israel at that point was a fractured nation. It was really only a single tribe that remained, right? Judea, Judah. You know, but the rest of Israel had been scattered centuries previously. And one of the things that Messiah would do was to gather all his people. It's one thing that they hoped for, right? And he was, of course, he is the redeemer and restorer of Israel. But he was not so in the way that they hoped, right? Their idea of the coming Messiah was that of a reigning and conquering king, right? Triumphing over all of Israel's enemies, the Lion of Judah. Right? But what they failed to discern from the law and the prophets was that though he would come in that way as a lion, and he still will, he would first have to come as a lamb, a suffering servant. But as it was, they were already suffering under the imperial grip of Rome, right? And probably didn't desire more of that suffering internally. Moreover, as the hyper-religious gatekeepers they were, remember, they likely assumed that the Christ would be more endearing towards them. Right, even approving of their rituals, right, and their traditions and the general ethos on holy living. However, they were sorely mistaken, because at almost every turn, Jesus was rebuking or reproving them. And having committed themselves to opposing him, no amount of evidence would be sufficient for them, though they ask again and again. But what about their question itself that we read back in our chapter 10? Had Jesus been keeping them in suspense? Right? Or what about their demand? Had he been obscure and not plain about his identity heretofore by that point? By no means. By no means. When he was betrayed even, right? And this comes later. When he was betrayed, arrested, and brought before the high priest for questioning in John 18, listen to what he says. John 18, 20 through 21. Jesus answered him, I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in the synagogues and in the temple where all Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? He was asking about him and his disciples and his work. Ask those who have heard me what I said to them, and they know what I said. They could have sought out the countless individuals who had been transformed by Jesus by that point, right? From the woman at the well to her Samaritan neighbors to the formerly blind beggar, right? That he just healed a chapter earlier, again in chapter 9. In his case, they actually did. They came and questioned him twice, but sadly to no avail. Because regardless, the reality is, no one has been clearer about himself than Jesus has been, right? And even if you go back to what he said to Nicodemus about wicked deeds versus deeds done in truth, we find that his modus operandi has always been entirely consistent. John 3, 20 to 21, Pastor Phil will preach on this eventually. For anyone who does wicked things, hates the light, and does not come to the light, lest his works be exposed. But whoever does what is true comes to the light, so that it might be clearly seen that his works have been carried out in God. And that's the thing, right? The motives behind these sleuths, right, these phony detectives, has been to undermine the authority of Jesus, and if possible, to ensnare him in his own words or actions, right? And as we see even today in our lives, right, as his disciples, we walk that fine line, do we not? Right, as sheep sent out in the midst of wolves, we require the wisdom of the serpent with the gentleness of the dove, right? We encounter hostility and even subtle craftiness, right, from on the part of certain individuals who hate God, right, and by extension, hate us, right, who look and wait for every and any opportunity to try and trip us up in something we either say or do, right? And so this calls for us to be sober-minded, for one, right, but also to be ready and also to be gracious. Jesus could have ignored the questioners, right, knowing full well what their minds had already been made up to do, but he chose rather to respond, trusting in the word of the Lord and knowing that it never returns void, but always accomplishes all that it sets out to do. Furthermore, considering the opposition, right, that the opposition were not only Jews in earshot, but also the disciples and others, right, apart from the opposition, rather, were also the disciples and others. There were other people around him. Why would he withhold that truth, right? Because even though some would be rooted in unbelief, others might hear and believe, right? And as I mentioned, the division was forming over his words, right? He was saying some very controversial things, true things, but controversial things, right? And this was creating a division in Judea, right? Some would remain skeptical, others would believe. And may that be an encouragement for us to press on, right, when we preach, even publicly, even if we're faced with opposition. You're out on the street and someone's screaming at you and you're thinking, wow, what's going on? Am I doing this wrong? You don't know who else is listening. And you don't know who else, what God might be doing in them, right? When we preach in public, consider that the word could very well be working in ways that you might not see right then and there. But moving along, having looked at the questionable sleuth, we see Jesus' response in point number two, the undeniable proofs, verses 25 to 29. We'll be parked here because this is a big chunk of our text. But John 10, verses 25 to 29, Jesus answered them, follow along, I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name bear witness about me, but you do not believe because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. Amen. Well, contrary to their previous assumptions, Jesus answers them rather plainly, right? He claims to have told them before, right, that he was the Christ. He claims to have told them already. And what we find is that the disconnect here, right, lies not so much in any lack of evidence, right, but rather in their unwillingness to accept the evidence provided. And man, oh man, talk about solid evidence. Firstly, we see the works, right? He says in verse 25b, the works that I do in my Father's name bear witness about me. What are these works? We're going to be concluding this Tuesday, the series, as we had last year, of the works, the miraculous works of the Lord and what they tell us about him. There are no shortage of works. But what were these works here for the purpose of this sermon? Time would fail me to honestly capture each and every one. And interestingly enough, so would all the books of the world if they were to be penned about this subject. Right? John himself, the author of the gospel, says it at the very last verse. But even if we took a cursory glance at the mighty works of John that John records for us alone up to this point, the argument would be overwhelming. Right? We have as his first work the miracle at the wedding of Cana in Galilee, right, where he turned water into wine instantly. John 2. Then, of course, there was the healing of the official's son, and he didn't even need to be present for that. He was like, go, your son's healed. John 5. Right, we saw that the healing of the lame, as I mentioned just previously, of the invalid, right, at the pool of Bethesda. right? In the next chapter, John 6, we open with the feeding of 5,000 people. What did he use to feed 5,000 people? 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. Is that not compelling? Following this, if that wasn't enough, he walks on water to meet his disciples in the middle of the night. Lastly, in chapter 9, the chapter right before ours, he heals a man born blind, the likes of which had not been done before since the creation of the world, which the blind man himself asserts, right? And besides these were his display of omniscience, right? He perceived Nathanael's location under the fig tree when no one else was around him and no one else could have known where he was. The woman at the well's marital history. How did he know how many wives she had previously? But then also the hearts and minds of all men, right? Men to whom he didn't entrust himself, men that wanted to make him king, and so he fled. He knew what was in the hearts of men, and certainly these Pharisees. And again, looking at the man who had been formerly blind, even he was utterly perplexed by the Pharisees' obstinance, right? When they questioned him, this is now the second time, John 9:30-33, the man answered, "Why, this is an amazing thing. You do not know where he comes from, and yet he's opened my eyes? We know that God does not listen to sinners. But if anyone is a worshiper of God and he does his will, God listens to him. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man born blind. If this man were not from God, he can do nothing." He saw it. And how much theological training did he have in comparison to the people who were questioning him? A man who'd previously never seen light nor the temple had a greater theological understanding than the supposed titans of the law, right? And all it took was one encounter with Jesus and the right heart. Because that's what it boils down to, the heart, right? In his parable of the rich man and Lazarus from Luke 16, speaking through Abraham, Jesus says, responding to the condemned who requested for Lazarus to go and warn his relatives of their impending doom, right? Luke 16:31, he said to them, "If they do not hear Moses and the prophets, neither will they be convinced if someone rises from the dead." So no amount of miracles alone can ever convince anyone of the truth of Christ. Because ultimately, salvation is not an issue of evidence, ultimately, but of faith and belief, right? And I've spoken to countless believers, perhaps unbelievers, perhaps have many of you as well, that they're like, "If only I had proof. If only God would show me some amazing thing, then I believe. Why do you want me to believe someone I've never seen?" You know, they think, "If you show me this, then I'll believe." Echoing the Pharisees, who said, "Show us a sign in the heavens," right? And this is just simply not true, right? God walked among men as Jesus in the flesh and did things that no man has ever or can ever or will ever do, right? And still they did not believe. And why not? Jesus continues in verse 26-27, "But you do not believe," why? "Because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me." And what this underscores is the sovereignty of God in election, right? There are a select group of individuals who belong to Christ and who have from eternity past. And he identifies them metaphorically here as his sheep, right? And just think about it. This implies many things, such as possession, right? My sheep, his sheep, but also provision. Sheep are entirely dependent on their shepherds. They can't do anything. We're not familiar with that in living in the social context we are, but sheep can't do anything without their shepherd. So it also displays his tender care for them, right? This imagery would have resonated quite well with them, right? First century Jews were an agrarian people, with livestock being a very much a central part of their lives, their daily existence. And even within the sphere of God's word, they could have drawn the connections, right? We see this going back to the Old Testament, and perhaps most prominently with King David, AKA the sweet psalmist of Israel. He writes in one of his most famous psalms, Psalm 23, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod, your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever." Before David was a king, he was a shepherd. And so too was his promised descendant, his promised seed, his offspring, spiritually speaking, and that being the Christ. right? He's not only, and the thing about him, right, Jesus, he's not only a shepherd, but the good shepherd, right? His sheep, therefore then, as him being the good shepherd, must be quite special, right? And of course, not by virtue of any innate quality that they possess, but by virtue of who they belong to. Alternatively, all others by definition, right? All who aren't his sheep, all who are outside his fold, do not belong to him. And that's the sad truth. What are the marks of his sheep, and how can they be identified? Firstly, as we read, his sheep hear his voice. What does that mean? It means we recognize his call. I once saw a video of a shepherd. He had a friend or associate with him, someone who nevertheless was unfamiliar with those particular sheep, and they were outside the sheep pen on one side. All the sheep were just in the pen grazing and eating grass, what sheep do. And the shepherd invites the other man to try to call the sheep. Now, this man had been around him and must have known the pitch and the tone and the verbalization of the call, and he tried to do it. The sheep didn't bat a single eye. They just, business as usual. As soon as the shepherd called, doing the same exact thing, those sheep came running. They came running to him, right? Every last one, some slower than others, but all arrived at full attention, awaiting further commands nonetheless. And God's people have ears to hear, right? A command Jesus would often utter at the end of his parables, right? Or his figurative sayings. They always come, right, his people, his sheep, when they're called, because they know the voice of the one who is calling them. Just like a parent knows the voice and the cry of their child from across the room in a sea of other kids, and likewise, the child that called that parent, so too do the sheep know the call of their shepherd, right? And his people know the call of Jesus. God's people have ears to ears. And if you know his voice today, which, mind you, is not an audible one, you have much reason to rejoice. Right? Perhaps you remember when the gospel first took root in your heart, right? And you understood the truth. Maybe you've heard it hundreds of times before that, but this one particular time, it sank down and it blew your mind, Perhaps you remember, right, when you finally opened that Bible or finally read that tract that your coworker gave to you months previously, right, and something just clicked. However, it is that you heard it. It's not merely that you heard it. The joy is that you actually understood it, right? That you recognize the call, the voice, right? There are many in this world, and likely some in this room right now, sorrowfully to say, who do not hear and do not understand the word and the call of the Lord. And our hearts ought to break over them. And our prayers and our continued efforts, the reason why we preach the gospel, we sing the songs, and we inundate our service in the word of God, even afterwards, is hopefully we go down for refreshments and we encourage one another, hopefully in the word, not just in things of the world, to be aimed, at least in one sense, to the end that some of those people might hear and believe, right? Holiness, without which who will see the Lord? How will they know the Lord if not for us sharing with them? And we must pray because we know it's not of our own efforts. But another mark of the sheep is that they are known by God. Well, Mike, isn't everyone known by God? Well, yes and no. Yes, in the sense that God knows everyone and everything perfectly, right? This is the doctrine of the omniscience, God's omniscience. This is crystallized in Hebrews 4:13, where we read, "No creature is hidden from his sight, but all are naked and exposed to the eyes of him to whom we must give an account." But the answer is also no when we consider the nature of this knowledge to which Jesus refers, right? This is an intimate knowledge, right? Akin to the knowledge that Adam had of his wife Eve, right? When he says Adam knew Eve, right? It wasn't just, "I know about her." He knows them inside out, right? His sheep. It's also a relational and salvific knowledge. Christ knows his sheep in a saving way, right? If you look at verse 3 of our chapter, he knows and calls them by name. That is individually, right? It's not kind of just like a lazy, "All right, you, come over here." No, you, Jacob, Greg, anyone who is his sheep, he calls by name, right? And leads them out. So he knows them in a saving way. And if that were not personal enough, he bore each of their sins in his own body on the cross, paying for them with his blood, right? Today, and today he even intercedes for them. What love is this, right? That God would know us. Who are we? Who are we, honestly, that God would know us? But the reality is, if you are his sheep, then you know, you are known in a greater way than you can ever know anything or even know yourself, right? And if God knows the depth of your depravity, right, and yet loved you with an everlasting love, knowing what you would do, knowing that you would fall away from him, but save you nonetheless, right, and love you with an everlasting love, is there anything that you could ever do, possibly, to surprise him or to shock him or to sway his love? If you could, you'd be the first. Another mark of the Lord's sheep is that they follow him. Obedience, right? Faithful and willing obedience. Christ himself, right, humbled himself and came in the form of flesh and obediently lived after the will of his Father. Everything he did and said was according to the Father's will, right? And that ought to be a defining hallmark for the people of Christ, should it not, right? When he calls, remember, when the shepherd calls the sheep, they come, right? And when he leads them, they follow him out wherever he goes. It's obedience. If we call him Lord, Lord, are we to not then do that which he commands us, right? Is his yoke easy and burden light as he says it is, or are his commands burdensome to us, right? Do we love what he loves and hate what he hates, or do we even know what his will is? Do we even know what he loves? Do we even know what he hates? Are we in his word? We have to be honest with ourselves and examine these things closely, lest we be deceived, or even as Christians, just rendered unfruitful. But while we can look at this mark as a warning and a prompt to careful self-examination, we can also see it as an encouragement, right? Something like a principle or a law, such as the law of gravity, right? What I mean by this is that if we are his sheep, then we will obey him, right? We've been changed from our former state, right? Our former deadness. We've been given a new heart, a heart of flesh, whereas there was once a heart of stone. But before, we could not and would not do anything pleasing to the Lord, right? But now he's given us a new heart, right? A heart that yearns to love God. Sure, we're often beset by the flesh and just human weakness and limitation, but nonetheless, because of his grace and his grace alone in our inner man, right, we are now full of these desires to live for God, right? Because we love him and grow to love him increasingly all the more as we abide in him, right? So in the end, his sheep will hear, right? They are known and will follow him. And this comfort shouldn't be by any means a cause for us to be laxed or without zeal or in our walks. Just the contrary, knowing that his sheep will follow him, that should spur us on all the more with joy to actually do it, to actually live passionately for him. Lord, you've enabled me to live for you. Now let me do it. Because as Paul says in Galatians 2:20, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who what? Who loved me and gave himself for me. And in addition to the comfort of who we are as Christ's sheep, it's also the reality of our eternal security in both him and the Father. And we move on to verses 28 and 29. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. Right? Eternal life is the reward of the sheep. Right? It's our consolation. That and Christ, of course, right? The giver of eternal life. And as he prays seven chapters later, right, in his high priestly prayer, John 17:3, we see that more than a merely unending life, eternal life is that intimate and relational knowledge of God, of the Father, and of course of the Son whom he sent into the world to redeem us from our sin. And we can rest in that fact, right? The fact that nothing and no one can or will ever snatch us out of their combined grip. I mean, just think about it. What can you possibly get out of God's hands, right? We're locked in those hands. You can more easily get into Fort Knox blindfolded and disabled than you can get anything or anyone out of the hands of God. You can't pry the sheep from his hands. And that is a tremendous comfort, right? And you can consider what the Apostle Paul writes at the end of Romans 8 concerning the everlasting love of God, verses 31 to 39. What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things? Who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who it is to condemn? Christ Jesus is the one who died, more than that, who was raised, who is at the right hand of God, who is indeed interceding for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither life nor death nor angels nor rulers nor things present nor things to come nor powers nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. So these two things, right, namely the works of God, the works of Christ, and the people, his sheep, the people of Christ, right, who in one sense are also the works, right, if you consider that we are his workmanship, created in who? In Christ Jesus. These things, the works and the people, testify to who Christ is, right, to his power, but also to his great love. Because again, who are we that we should be the people of God? And to put the cherry on top is what Jesus said next. So we looked at the questionable sleuth, right? And point number one, the undeniable proof. And now lastly, point number three, the incontrovertible truth, verse 30. And this is a short verse, but tremendously deep. Well, I feel time is betraying me. John 10:30, I and the Father are one. This one verse, right, consisting in our English language of six short words, has been the subject of countless sermons, right? But this is the answer. This is the answer. They asked, how long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly. This is above and beyond the answer, right? The Jews asked to be relieved from suspense and to know plainly whether or not he was the Christ, and they got their answer. He could not have been more clear about it, right? And this is demonstrated by what they're about to do, which is not the subject of my current subject, but if you read on in verse 31, you know what they're about to do. And not only was his answer, right, to the question of the Christ in the affirmative, a yes, right? He was revealed to be the Lord's Christ, but he was revealed to be the Lord himself, right, in the flesh. And again, we see this affirmed and even echoed elsewhere. Paul in Colossians 1:16-17 affirms Jesus' this very same fact, right? Colossians 1:16-17, in him all things were created, things in heaven and on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or powers or rulers or authorities, all things, think of something, that too was created, right? All things have been created through him and for him. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together, right? And again, John 1:1, right, which we read earlier before the sermon, explicitly notes, right, that Jesus was both with God in the beginning and was God, right? The very one they claimed to believe and worship, right, the whole lineage of Israel and the people of Judea, right, was staring them face to face. Again, as we'll see as you read on, their response to this was anything but the correct one. Right, and of course, when we're talking about this oneness between the Father and Jesus, we see another clear revelation of the Trinity, right? We see two of its members. Of course, the Father, God the Father, first person of the Trinity, and second, God the Son. And all over the scriptures, both in the New Testament and Old, we see further evidences of that. There's no word Trinity in the Bible, but there are certainly teachers that clearly point to and establish and prove it. And so Jesus not only was God, is God, right? He is the Father, right? He is one with the Father, rather. He is not the Father, and the Father is not the Son, right? They're eternally existing different persons in one being, and that's the oneness that they're talking about, right? Even that word, one, it's rather than the masculine form, it's the neuter, which speaks not so much to them being the same person, but one being, right? And their will, right? And what they set out to accomplish, right? They're one in that sense, right? In summary, Jesus claimed to be one with the Father as part of a larger argument, right? To note that he existed from eternity past, right? He's eternal. That's why he can give eternal life. He knows what it is, right? He lived in perfect oneness with the Father, perfect unity, perfect harmony, right? They had one plan and they fulfilled separate roles within that plan. Different persons, let me reiterate, one being, held the same power. He held the same power as God, which was clearly demonstrated through the works, right? And he would say at another point in the gospel, if you don't believe me, I think later on in the chapter, believe on account of the works. If you don't believe what I'm telling you, believe on account of what you're seeing. How do you explain otherwise what you're seeing and what you're hearing and what you've experienced? Held the same power. And that he was sent by God the Father's authority, right? Jesus wasn't a lone wolf. He wasn't acting independently of the Father. He was doing everything that the Father tasked him. Even us, right? The people that were coming to believe in him, it was the Father, again, sending, sovereignly sending and working in their lives to send them to the Son. And it's the same way it happens with us in salvation, right? Unfortunately, he was rejected as divine by the Jewish leaders. And to them, Jesus' claim to have power equal with God was paramount to blasphemy. But we know it was not blasphemy. It was the plain and incontrovertible truth, right? A truth that has been debated for two millennia now, but is nonetheless and will in the end be unequivocally seen to be truth. When we stand before, when all mankind stands before Christ as the judge, they're gonna know, right? And the question is, what does that mean for us, right? If Christ is Lord, if he is one with the Father, how then shall we live, right? If we're his people, that means full and complete surrender, utter obedience. What else can that mean? If we were, you know, like in the Jews in their mind, they would say that they believe God, and so they would do these things to obey him. Now Jesus is declaring to them, by not only by word, but deed, that he was God. Therefore, their reaction should have been fall down and worship. And every time someone did that in the Gospels, he would accept it because it was right, because he is God, right? And so for us, the same thing is true. Do you believe that Jesus is God? Do you believe he made you? He knows you. Therefore, you belong to him in every way. You're held accountable to him. And he's given you time. Even this sermon, even the fact that you can be in a place where you hear this call and this word is a grace that he is affording to you that many in hell don't have right now. So if you don't believe, you need to know that you must believe. You don't know when your time is up, but you know you can bet your bottom dollar that Christ is Lord. He is God. He is King. He is one with the Father. And if you believe this day, again, it's a tremendous joy, right? To know that God, who we have not seen, right? Christ has made him known, right? And again, what we read in John 1, you know, that no one has seen the one true God, but Jesus Christ has made him known. That word is communicated. He is basically what we understand, what we can understand of God, we have in the person of Jesus Christ, right? Because we're human, so we need human physical things, and Christ is that for us. And so that is a tremendous joy, and we can walk and obey and just walk confidently in that, knowing that, you know, when we pray, we're praying to a risen Lord. And that he's with us, even to the end of the age. He clearly is Lord, and may our hearts obey him. Let's now close with prayer. Father, Lord, we thank you. We thank you that you were pleased to send your Son, Lord, your beloved Son, whom you were well pleased, whom you loved, because he gave his life for the sheep. And he laid down his life, and no one took it from him, but he laid it down of his own accord. And so you were pleased, and love him, O God. And I thank you that on Calvary, all the sins of his people were placed upon him. Lord, I ask, O God, that you make real, O Lord, this truth to those who have not yet embraced it, O God. Those who think that you are holding them in suspense, O Lord. Those who have not had it plainly revealed. Oh God, may you overcome the hardness of heart, oh Lord. And for your people, oh God, may you just continue to encourage us to know that the God we believe in is the living God, is one with you, Father. We thank you so much. In Jesus' blessed name, amen.